In this video, we'll compare Nginx and Traffic using both as reverse proxies. We'll measure latency from the client side using P99 percentile throughput by counting how many requests per second each proxy can handle, and availability or error rate for each service, especially important when the proxy is heavily loaded. Next, we'll measure CPU usage, memory usage, and network traffic. Additionally, we'll measure CPU and memory usage of the backend applications. In recent benchmarks, I complained that applications behind Nginx experience a significantly higher load compared to Apache and Kdi. In this video, I'll explain the reason for this and how to fix it. I run all my tests in AWS using exactly the same infrastructure as in my production environments. I use M7A large instances to deploy each proxy and 4 medium EC2 instances for each application behind each proxy. Additionally, I create EKS cluster using Graviton instances to deploy monitoring components such as Prometheus and Grafana, as well as to deploy clients to generate load. So, what is a reverse proxy? It is a server that sits in front of your application and routes all incoming requests to the application instances behind it. One of the most important features of the reverse proxy is the ability to act as a load balancer, allowing you to dynamically scale your application. For example, during the day, your online store might experience high traffic and require 10 application instances. But at night, traffic is low, and you can scale down to 1 or 2 instances. A reverse proxy allows you to scale your application without impacting users, which ultimately helps reduce your infrastructure costs. The second function, which I think is also very important, is the ability to upgrade your application behind the reverse proxy without downtime, as you can do it one instance at a time. I also frequently terminate TLS at the reverse proxy level and then route plain HTTP traffic to the application. If you have hundreds of these applications, offloading TLS on the application level itself can be more CPU intensive, and you also need to rotate certificates regularly, maybe every 60 days. This adds additional load on your DevOps team. Since clients only interact with reverse proxies, your application is not directly exposed to the internet. This reduces attack surface and potential for exploits. You can also perform caching on reverse proxies for some common requests, such as static content like HTML, CSS, or JavaScript files. And of course, you can enable compression to reduce the size of the payload that clients need to download. This decreases latency and improves overall performance. Now, let's compare these two proxies, starting with configuration. Nginx was created a long time ago and is primarily configured using static configuration files. This approach works well, but it does require time to learn and optimize for production use. In the next video, I'll cover ingress controller as well. On the other hand, Traffic has several built-in service discovery mechanisms. You can define routes with static files, similar to Nginx, or use dynamic discovery. For example, when deploying traffic with a Docker Compose file, it can automatically discover all applications and configure routes accordingly. Second, if you want to secure Nginx with a TLS certificate, which is most likely the case, unless it is used within your VPC, you'll need to install additional component called Certbot. Certbot can automatically handle HTTP 01 or DNS 01 challenges if you're using Let's Encrypt, and it will also renew your certificates every 60 days. On the other hand, Traffic has this functionality built in. This makes it easier to manage, obtain, and renew certificates. One thing I really dislike about open source Nginx is that it doesn't expose metrics for each application it serves. For instance, it would be helpful if it provided HTTP status codes, along with request methods like get and post. This feature is only available in the paid version. While there are some workarounds, such as parsing access logs or using certain plugins, this limitation is a major weakness of Nginx. However, metrics are available in the Nginx ingress controller, which I'll cover next. Traffic, on the other hand, natively exposes metrics in Prometheus format, which you can easily scrape. Lastly, there is a significant performance difference between these two proxies, which we'll explore in the actual tests. Just keep in mind, in the cloud, performance directly translates to the cost of your infrastructure. Also, remember that Nginx can serve both static content like a website and act as a reverse proxy. Traffic, however, does not support serving static content, which might be a deal breaker for those who need that functionality. I'm using the latest versions available at this time, Nginx 1.27.2 and Traffic 3.2.0. Here is the main Nginx configuration file with some optimizations. All configuration files available in my public GitHub repo. Since I always enable access logs in real production environment, I have enabled them for both proxies in this test as well. Next, we have proxy configuration itself. I have four instances behind each proxy. I'm using self-signed certificate and HTTPS, and I also upgraded each connection to HTTP2, a more efficient binary protocol. I included common headers in both proxies, like x4.4 to provide real IP address of the client, along with other headers typical for reverse proxies. Keep in mind that other proxies like Keri and Traffic handle most of this by default, but with Nginx, these settings need to be configured manually. On the other hand, we have Traffic along with its main configuration file. As you can see, I'm not using dynamic configuration. Instead, I'm using file provider. I have also enabled access logs, which are similar to Nginx. Additionally, I'm only listening on port 443. If you prefer, you can configure a redirect from port 80 to 443, but it's optional. Now, regarding the file provider, I'm also using four backend applications with Traffic and providing a self-signed certificate. To run it on the VM, I'm using systemd service file, pretty much the same as Nginx. I'm not biased at all. If you can improve performance of your favorite proxy, I'll be glad to rerun the test. For this test, I'm using AWS and creating all networking components from scratch with Terraform. I provision M7A large EC2 instance for each proxy and four medium EC2 instances behind each proxy to route traffic. To run the proxies and applications, I use systemd service as well. I also create EKS cluster with a single instance based on Graviton and deploy Prometheus, Grafana, and 20 pods per proxy to generate load. Alright, let's go ahead and run the first test. I think one of the most important metrics for client-facing applications is latency. Right from the start, you can see that Nginx maintain much lower latency throughout the test. You don't want your proxy to add extra latency, so lower is definitely better. We're also measuring the number of requests per second each proxy receives. On the right-hand side, we have CPU usage, which clearly shows that if a proxy consumes more CPU, it will lead to higher latency and ultimately lower throughput. In my previous benchmarks with Nginx, I often complain that applications behind Nginx experience much higher load compared to those behind other proxies. The reason for this behavior is that by default, Nginx does not use Keep Alive for its backend applications, while all other proxies do. I received a pull request explaining this, so if you're using Nginx as a reverse proxy, make sure to explicitly enable Keep Alive. It will significantly improve Nginx performance. Without Keep Alive, each time Nginx receives a request, it must establish a new network connection to the backend application, which is expensive. With Keep Alive, Nginx can simply reuse those connections. For some reason, this is not the default behavior in Nginx. At around 17,000 requests per second, It looks like traffic starts to fall behind Nginx and can no longer process all incoming requests. Since traffic is reaching nearly 100% CPU usage, this appears to be maximum throughput it can handle. At this time, the difference in latency between these two proxies is significant. I also measured network traffic for each proxy, and traffic uses slightly more, likely because it sends a few more additional headers. The payload size is small, so compression is not enabled, as it wouldn't be effective for such small payloads. Now, let's see how much more Nginx can manage. Nginx gradually reaches 40,000 requests per second, compared to traffic's 17,000. By the end, you can see that applications behind Nginx are using more CPU, simply because Nginx handle and route more requests to them. Alright, let's look at each graph over the entire test duration. First, we have requests per second. While it doesn't directly impact user experience, this metric directly translates to infrastructure cost. Users don't care about your traffic volume, but by using a more efficient proxy, you could potentially cut infrastructure costs by nearly half. Now, the most important metric for providing a better user experience is latency. Lower latency is always better. Overall, Nginx latency is lower, but let's also take a look at the start of the test. Nginx latency remains very stable throughout, even under load, while traffic's latency starts to increase as soon as the test begins. I'm measuring latency from the client side with identical histogram buckets, not using internal metrics, so these results are accurate and independent of each proxy. Next is CPU usage. You can see that traffic's CPU usage quickly spikes to 100%, while Nginx takes twice as long to reach full CPU usage. Now, let's look at memory usage. It seems that traffic is caching more requests over time, which is likely why its latency keeps increasing, whereas Nginx memory usage remains relatively flat. Another critical metric for user experience is error rate, or how many client requests fail. There is a difference here. Traffic attempts to process every single request, which impacts latency, while Nginx drops a few requests to ensure the majority are handled with low latency. When we look at the percentage, it's only one or two requests failing out of thousands per second, resulting in 99.99% availability. So this isn't a significant issue. Now, let's check CPU usage for applications behind the proxies. It's consistent in this test because I used Keep Alive, and it's higher at the end simply because Nginx processes more requests. As for network traffic, traffic initially transmits slightly more due to additional headers, but by the end of the test, Nginx has transmitted twice as much data as traffic. Finally, we have memory usage for applications behind Nginx, which doesn't play a role in this test. If you can improve traffic, I would be glad to rerun the test and, more importantly, share any performance improvements with others considering traffic. I have other benchmarks that you might find interesting in this playlist. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.